Hi, everyone. Welcome to the podcast. We have that long anticipated guest, Miss Lynette Zang, who is graciously joining us for today's podcast to talk about all things reset, gold and silver, and the economic status of America and throughout the entirety of the world. So if you are new to the podcast, please do like, subscribe, and share as it helps the channel grow. As you know, as we've had Lynette on before, she is a gold and silver aficionado with well over 60 plus years in the financial world industry. And she, like us, is all about community support and bartering. So we have much in common and we look forward to closing on that gap more so. Lynette, how are you doing today, my dear? Welcome.
I am doing great and so happy to be here, John. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Believe me, it's as I told you offline, it's been a minute over the summer, but we couldn't have come together at a better time with where the state of things are. And speaking of which, I wanted to ask you the first question, which is, Lynette, as we look at the Dow, I know you're a student of history. Going back to 2001, it was trading around, I believe, the 10,000 mark, and now it's well over 40,000, nearly four times where it was, but yet gold is actually 10 times higher than it was. So it seems gold is outpacing the markets. My question is, do you see this trend continuing over the next 5 to 10 years? And if so, assuming the Fed does get audited, how high do you think gold could go?
Well, you know, do I see, if you mean that, is there going to be a continuation into the markets to push them up? Then that's absolutely correct. And we cannot negate what just happened between the PBOC stimulation and the Fed pivot, because they have basically what they've said is we're ready for hyperinflation. So yeah, I think you're going to see the stock markets continue to go up. But when I'm looking at the gold market, just like when I'm looking at the silver market, they're two different markets, right? So there's the spot gold and spot silver market that we've been trained to think of is the true valuation for gold and silver, which it's not. And then there is the physical only market. So number one, yes, I do think that the spot gold and the spot silver market will continue to go up. I think that in silver, we will see maybe even by the end of this year, maybe it'll take a little bit longer, I don't know. But I think we will see a cup conclusion in the silver market. And that means that if there is a price target, it'd be about 50 bucks an ounce on silver, even though that is the spot market, it's still way undervalued to its true value. In the gold market, that will continue to go up. I don't know quite where it's going to bump its head, because remember, that's a contract. And so what you're looking at is, in both of these cases, is a trading market. But truthfully, since they can create as much gold and silver that does not nor ever will exist, when you see spot gold trading at these levels, does that mean that Wall Street has overtaken the spot market and from the central bank market and is going to push the prices much higher? Would not surprise me to see see the spot gold contract at, you know, 3,000 by the end of this year or somewhere in there. But even so, neither one of those numbers represent the true value in terms of this fiat money for gold or silver. So where you find real price discovery to actually know what's happening in the gold markets is the collectible market, where it's physical only, right? It's not a contract, it's physical only. And I see those also, well, in the upper echelon, where you might have an ounce of gold go for 15 million or more, you know, who can afford that? Those are the movers and shakers, the 1% that either write the rules or have the ability to influence those that write the rules. And what you see when you go to the physical only market and you make a comparison between the ultra rarities, which is where the wealthy play, to just the common, which this is just more of a common, but still in that same category. And then you go to this market, which the spot market, which is which straddles both worlds. But what you really see when you look at that is the ultra rarities where the rich play break out first. And that's trading at all time ever, all time highs. Then you go to this market and this market breaks out second. And then you go to the spot market that straddles both worlds and that breaks out third. So if you really want to know what's going on, look at the ultra rarities. Really where you're going to get more honesty and more truth than you are in, certainly in the spot markets.
Good point. Thanks for the delineation on that. So that kind of leads Lynette to an interesting follow-up question. I was thinking about sort of extemporaneously as you were sharing your views on that, which is, you know, we see gold and silver breaking out now that we're in the new fiscal year, October 1, right? Financially speaking, of course, not calendar year. I'm saying to my audience, you already know that. We're now in the new first quarter of the new fiscal year. The Basel III has kicked in for the banks collectively, tier one specifically. You're nodding your head, so that's good. That means we have the right information. So with all that said, how are they able to suppress it down if they can't paper contract anymore with transparency?
Yeah, well, there's transparency and there's transparency now, isn't there?
True.
You know, with Wall Street, all of these things that they put together are extraordinarily complicated. So you're never, ever, ever going to get good. Well, I don't know that. Actually, that's probably, I just misspoke. At this point in time, there is no way that you're ever going to get good price discovery because could all of those, I don't know, thousands of gold and silver contracts be settled? No. So I think that the biggest thing for me about Basel III being executed is more about the bail-in, because we've watched them dismantle the parts for the banks in the Dodd-Frank Act and also the postponement and whatever that they've done in Basel III. That's not going to fix it. What they've done really is just use this again as a transfer, a wealth transfer mechanism. So it's good that it's a tier one, and it kind of makes it look like it'd be a little more honest. But you know where you can also really see it and where you would maybe pay attention to it for a little bit more honesty is if you go into the OCC, the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency, and on that, their report on derivatives in the FDIC insured banks, because these derivatives, and you can look specifically to the precious metals derivatives, primarily gold, and it's really interesting because they kind of shifted the accounting mechanism a couple of years ago. So you see that they're just held these contracts really low level and then ba-bam, right? So that's really what I'm looking at, because even when I look at those contracts, that's what they are.
Yeah.
Contracts. They aren't gold or silver in the physical form. Are they just demolish that whole market and implode everything? No.
Yeah.
It's the keyword confidence.
Sorry. Yeah, it is. Well, you said the key word con right there is the beginning part. And you also said, before we go forward, Lynette, I think it's a really important point, in my humble opinion, that you underscore what you said, wealth transfer mechanism, because we're going to talk about that at the end. And that's exactly what's going on for the right people, because it goes back to what you said this summer, that we're increasing. So, you know, I listened to you, we're increasing the odds of bringing more people to the table. So it's less of a 1% and maybe, you know, 3-5%. But if we do our part in these types of shows, we increase that probability. So thank you for your part in that. So next question is, the Fed is planning two more rate cuts for the year, or possibly one. November 7th is the next meeting with the Fed. I guess the question would be twofold. Do you think it'll be 225 basis points or 150 basis point again and before the end of the year? And if so, what does that do to the dollar index?
Well, I you know, when they did the 50 basis point cut just recently, you know, what they wanted you to believe is because everything is so strong and that this is going to help the workers. And then we just got this really big, you know, jobs report, which is probably going to be shifted in a few months when it doesn't matter anymore. So it's lie upon lie upon lie. I'm not sure. It's going to be interesting to see. I'll tell you why. Because with this shift, what they're doing is they're encouraging inflation, right? And when we see inflation rapidly rise, that gets the public's attention. The first time that they have ever eased into an already easy money cycle, even though they wanted you and they wanted everybody to believe that they were tightening. So a 50 basis point move is a panic move. I don't know that they want to bring that panic up. It's also not going to do anything for people that have lost their jobs because it takes a while to trickle through to the jobs numbers. So it's more about all the debt that is being issued by the government and by corporations and all the consolidations that are going on. So this is a long story to say, I don't really know what the Fed is going to do, but my bet would be probably 1/4 point move because the Wall Street wants it to get cheaper to reset to roll over the debt. And our government is issuing so much debt, no matter who gets in office, it's just going to be even more of that. But I don't think it matters. Honestly, I don't think it matters. And the reason is because you just had the two most powerful governments in the world announce that they were ready for hyperinflation by the stimulus and that big, huge drop in interest rates. So what's 1/4 point mean? It doesn't mean anything. It's a joke. They're on the path of inflation.
It's moot, is what you're saying, basically. In other words, I mean, it's fascinating, Lynette, because we're, as you know, historically, especially, we're in a period of time in this season where we're seeing things that people said would never happen are happening. So nothing would surprise me anymore, is I guess my overarching point. But like you said, they're going to have to make a panic move. I mean, all you got to do is they want you looking at the stock market. We know there's going to be corrections this month. We also know in our, when I'm speaking to my audience and yours respectively, because we're on the same alignment, that all you have to do is look at the uptick in inflation, which is a tax, right? Nothing more than that, on the deep state dollar, which is an IOU.
About
We,
confiscation?
a what?
How about taxes as a confiscation?
Touche. So, you're looking at groceries, looking at gas, looking at all these things. We're going to talk about oil towards the end with respect to BRICS, because I think they intertwine. But it's we're definitely going to see, I believe, things that we've never seen before, and we have to get to that wealth transfer mechanism, to your point. Month over month, Lynette, we've seen a steady growth in the S&P 500 index. I've heard it said that it could reach potentially 7,000 before the end of the year. Why is that significant? If it does reach that high, what does it translate for the global economic look short now, short and long term?
First of all, every time we're going into a hyperinflationary event, and I mean globally, countries do, you see a very rapid rise in the stock market as people are trying to escape and earn more, forced out onto that risk spectrum. But what you're really experiencing with the markets up that high, and to your point, most people are not really paying attention, but they'll open up their 401k statement or their IRA statement. And as long as things look like they're going up, then people think that that's everything must be okay, and they don't do anything to protect themselves. So we know that this is a mechanism to keep them in the system, making it so much easier to transition your wealth their way. And that's what this whole thing is about. It's a wealth transfer mechanism. And when enough risk has been transferred from the few, so from the elites, from the bankers, from the corporations and the individuals that run them, right? And we see so much insider trading. NVIDIA is a great example of that, right? When we see enough risk that gets transferred, then you will notice that it will become too expensive for the central banks to bail out the public. That 2020 stimulus, they couldn't do what they did in 2008 because the public would have like had a cow, right? But they also knew that if they're shutting people down and we're a consumer driven economy, and who was allowed to stay open? Mostly it was the big kahunas. And so we lost a lot of our mom and pop infrastructure, which were really the big drivers of employment, even more than the larger corporations, which are laying people off right and left. And I veered away from your question, John.
No, it's okay. That's all right. But we'll steer back.
Okay, veer me back.
No, I just basically, is the S&P 500, if we hit that number, wouldn't that suggest basically the question is hyperinflation? Wouldn't it be another marker?
Believe so, yes, because there's really not any doubt in my mind that we've already been at the beginning of that hyperinflation. Just look at the monetary velocity, the M2V over at the FRED, the Federal Reserve Education Department, and you're going to see a major pattern shift, major. Also, you know, when you're talking about the stock market, the VIX has gone into backwardation, which basically there's a lot of gobbledygook around there, but what the bottom line is that indicates that we're going to get a market correction, but that potentially it's very short-lived, because then the plunge protection team or whoever will go in to prop it up. The Federal Reserve, the banks, they'll go in to prop it up, because that's deflation, isn't it?
Yeah.
Market floating.
Yeah.
Inflation.
It's inverse, really. You got two different things going at each other, like a reverse weather front. And I'm just saying this, Lynette, to my audience, when she's talking about M2 or M2V, she's referring to the M2 money supply, your everyday money, stuff in your bank account, your metals, cash on hand, stuff you put in your mattress. That's what she's referring to, in case anybody's wondering. So we always usually have that. So thank you for that. So we've watched silver, speaking of silver, go over the $32 mark as of September 24th. I think it's, $30.50 as of right now, something like that last I checked, but we know it'll rebound. Thank you for the visual prop there. How high do you see silver going? You mentioned, I think, around $40 to $50, somewhere in that range. And then the other question I guess I was going to ask is, you know, people right now, I think there's, you see Costco selling, you know, gold and silver. They're now selling platinum, you know, so people are starting to notice that. People have a lot of silver in their possession, you know, flatware, cutlery, jewelry, silver panels, right? I think of 2 ounces of silver per panel. Thank you. And so what do you think will be the price point or the seminal moment where they'll start to recognize that and maybe start trying to extract some of those household items to get money?
Well, I think breaking out at that $50 level, right? A cup formation kind of looks like this. It's not smooth. It's kind of rough along the way.
Right. But
what that is it indicates that smart money is quietly accumulating.
Okay.
So I think that number particularly would be basically 50. I'd have to look on a chart to get a little more specific than that. But a break above that, then you're going to see the most likely outcome. And it kind of works like this. Here's a visual for that.
Sure.
You bought silver at $50 and then it dropped all the way down, right? And you decided to continue to hold it. And you said, man, if it ever gets to $50 again, I'm going to sell it, right? And so what that does is it creates a resistance level at the top, right? So when we go up to 50, right, you've got a whole pool of people that want to sell it because they've been holding it since it was 50. And that should put a little downward pressure on it. Okay, when that's done, then it goes back up. And we saw this with gold, where that had four tops, right, before it finally broke out. And once it broke out, then it keeps going up because there's no resistance left, right? That's the way that it works. It's just like on the bottom, there'll be a support, and hey, you wanted to buy it at 20 and you didn't do it, and now it's at 30 and you go, man, if it ever gets to 20 again, I'm gonna buy it, right? So then that creates that support. It's kind of an easy way to think about support and resistance at the top. But when we have that breakout at the top, then you're gonna see it shoot. And I don't know what it'll shoot to, but maybe 70, right? Does that mean that it's its true value? No.
No.
The true value of 1 ounce of silver is $2,000.
At
And the
least.
more money they print, the higher that number is going to go. And at some point, the same thing with gold, it's somewhere north of $40,000 an ounce, even though it's at like 26, whatever, at this moment. And as outrageous as those numbers sound, well, I don't know. People aren't going to like me for saying this. But Bitcoin at $60,000, and this isn't real, obviously, and Bitcoin isn't real, but they sure make it look like gold, don't they? Because they want you to think about this like this, but it's not. They just want the eyes on this, not on this, because this is going to get you more comfortable with the CBDCs. Never get me more comfortable with them, but...
Some people, yeah. Or that's the attempt anyway that they think they're going to get. Yeah, basically, I hear you saying, you know, buyer's remorse and FOMO, basically, with those prices. So that's just my short speak to it. So thank you again for that. So we know real money is gold and silver, obviously. But we're also converging into this new world with the digital economy that you just talked about and where those two worlds meet. So the old question in the 70s I heard was, what is truth? So maybe we need to ask ourselves with you, what is money? What's people's attitudinal mindset about money going to look like in the near future to you?
Well, actually, I'm super excited because to your earlier point with the Amazon and Walmart, et cetera, we are also seeing a resurgence on a global basis with the younger generation, not just people my age, but younger generation to buy gold and silver and also to get better control of their spending. Because quite frankly, the easier it is to spend money, the more of it you spend without thought, right? And so the younger generation is demanding tools and using more cash. There was, don't hold me to this because I don't have that right in front of me.
That's fine.
If I remember correctly, there was a 23% increase in cash use at like restaurants. And a lot of that is coming from the younger generation because they want to live within their means. They've been exposed to all the student loans and all of the debt that they have to service and how that really eats into what they can do. So I have a lot of high hope, and I think that we have entered a period of, let's call it Bretton Woods 3, right? That is commodity backed. But what people need to understand when you're talking about what is money, because the original what is money, it was supposed to be a tool of measure. Let's see, it's a, oh my goodness, I'm sorry, I'm tired.
No, it's okay.
It's a tool of measure so that you can be paid for your labor. It is a tool of barter so that we can equal everything out and your labor pays the appropriate amount for whatever the goods and services are. A short-term store of value to make sure that when you get paid, you're fairly paid. And a long-term store of value so that whenever you use that money, you remain fairly paid for the labor that generated it to begin with. Once the fiat money system came in, well, what happens if you save $50 over time? Everybody knows now that it does not buy you the same thing. So they've completely eliminated those last two, and they've officially eliminated that too. All to the government, to the central banks, what money is simply a tool of barter. And that's what they have been drumming into us. But I see a shift occurring that gives me a lot of hope. Number one, you're seeing more across the generations piling in, and particularly the public, into gold and silver, as witnessed by Amazon in the US, by Amazon, Walmart, and Costco, right? But also we're seeing that happen around the world and the increase in cash use, which is huge because they really want us to be into a purely digital system. But in Brenton Woods 3, now you're starting to hear all sorts of things about a digitally or a commodity backed, right? Whether it's a digital piece or it's a currency piece like we've seen with Zimbabwe. There is a difference between pegged and backed. And I really need people to understand this, because if something is truly backed by gold, then it needs to be convertible into that gold. In other words, if you don't like what they're doing, you can walk in with this and walk out with that, because that is what creates fiscal responsibility and restrictions around how much of this the central banks and the government can do. So that's my battle, is to really build that global community. And to your earlier point, just get even 3% of the population converting their garbage inflation addled fiat money into sound money. And why is it sound money? It's sound money versus this crappy fiat money, because it has the broadest base of functionality. That's what I want to see in my monetary, in my money system. I want the broadest base of demand, right? And this is used in every single sector of the global economy. So nanoparticles in medicine, film in space travel, it's in the monetary system, it's in the jewelry system, it's in the food system, it's in electronics, it's, you know,
everything.
On and on and on and on. But I'm sorry, unless you can convert it, as we just experienced with Zimbabwe, that vowed to hold their currency to the amount of gold and cash reserves they held. And boy, that didn't last very long, not quite 6 months before they did, boom, that overnight reset again, because it was just digital and you couldn't convert it. So how do you know? And we just saw an example of it.
Well, thank you for that. You know, also it's God's money, and it's lasted throughout the biblical times. And as you said, you know, being paid for your a fair wage, people used to, as you know, people used to get paid in salt salary. That's how that term derived. So I believe we're going to get back to that again. And these kinds of conversations, I think, help propagate that, to your point. As you know, we just had a 3-day strike, 45,000 seaport workers back east. Here on the West Coast, thankfully, they had a different contract, but they're taking on a lot of that load that the East Coast can't do. Could they be using that as an event to justify the hyperinflation that's coming? And two, what does this mean for other unionized industries? If the longshoreman union back east is going to get a higher pay wage of what, 62% or something, or whatever it's going to be when they reconvene January next year, what does that mean for other industries? Are they going to want to get paid more as well, fairly? How do you see that?
Well, I see that in a number of different ways and from a number of different angles. Number one, I absolutely love the rise of the unions, because it shows us the power in us as individuals coming together in community and taking a stance. And that's what we have to do with our monetary system. So that gives me the most hope ever. The strike was postponed until January, but we have to go back because everybody's watching the rise of the unions. This wasn't the first one that occurred. And what they're doing is they are kind of going against what the central banks want, which, what do they say? Well, one of their mandates is price stability. Okay. If you and I were going to define price stability, it means that gallon of milk stays the same. It has a stable price, right? Central bank's definition of price stability is inflation at a low enough rate that you, the worker, do not ask for more money. And that is getting blown to smithereens. That's the difference between slow enough inflation that you don't notice it, or you don't do anything about it, you don't change behavior, to fast inflation that we were just experiencing, where everybody is noticing it, and it's really hurt so many people.
And I mean, take a look, Lynette, at just a simple industry like sports. You notice the contracts there it is again. It's in everything in code and language. The contracts of some of these athletes are rising to ridiculously absurd rates beyond what they already were. Now you're getting athletes that were making $45 million to $421 million. You have to ask yourself, well, are they being overpaid? Yeah, but is that really a function of a dying dollar, that you have to pay them more just to equal what you did before because the dollar's falling off? You know, you're making that correlation, I think, is pretty important, you know, to your overall point. But yes, it is good to see people rising up.
Can we kind of stay there for just a second?
Absolutely.
Part of this is about private equity that is going in now and buying up the teams, and they've been going in and buying up the going up in and buying up the banks, and you know, and all of this private equity in earnest. I mean, there was a bit of it before, but it all really kicked into high gear, what, in 2009 or 10, with that free money that's being pumped into the system that you and I don't really have access to, but those that are chosen, they have access to it. So there's been this huge move toward private equity with all of this free money. And absolutely, to your point, it is a wealth transfer mechanism, but when money is free and cheap and easy and doesn't mean anything, $421 million, let's see, I do believe I have a $10 trillion Zimbabwe note. I am a trillionaire in Zimbabwe, but I can't buy anything with it.
For now. That's going to change, but we'll talk about that later. Jamie Dimon of Chase, as you know, recently came out and said he was supporting, putting politics aside, I'm just saying what he said, he's supporting President Trump for the upcoming election. And that kind of made my eyebrow raise a little bit. I was wondering, do you think this is an overture, is a genuine one, or is it a function of something bigger for the incoming economic collapse of the dollar and the support of the banks that they're going to need, given what just happened with Bank of America?
Mm-hmm. Could you go into what happened with Bank of America?
Yeah, I think it was roughly 10,000 people could not access their money and had zero showing up in their accounts, like a bail-in.
Okay, so I just wanted to make sure that that's what you were referring to.
Sure, certainly.
I don't think it matters who gets elected. All of them are talking about massive giveaways. And that means, you know, it's not like we think, well, the government's going to bail us out, or the government is printing all of this money. And what we really need to understand is that that's our money that they're spending, because that's our tax dollars, our children's tax dollars, and on into the future. But do I think that they're going to use this to justify the inflation? I think the war justifies the inflation. I think even that little shutdown, the three-day shutdown, that's not a little one, I'm sorry, but the shutdown of the ports is going to be a good excuse for that. You know, what's happening in the oil markets. I mean, everything they're going to use to point the finger at the culprit that's creating inflation, rather than just looking in the mirror and owning what they're doing, because their job is to lie.
Mm-hmm. So let's put them out of a job. That's what I say.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
No, I said let's put them out of a job. Let's help them find the unemployment line there.
I think that'd be a great idea. We don't really need the Fed, and quite frankly, do we?
No, we don't
really need the politicians now that we have blockchain.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, why can't I just vote for what I believe is the right thing to do? Why do I need a representative that doesn't take what I really want into consideration? With blockchain technology, they talk about how great that is for everything, but I haven't heard anybody other than Gerald Celente recommend that they use it for voting and get rid of a lot of the garbage and the fat that's in the system that costs us money. That's our money.
Right. Well, I believe that's where we're headed, Lynette, that goes back to when we talked about what is money, you know, that kind of think that where those two worlds intersect. I think that's where we're headed. Actually, I'm glad you said that because that allows me to show you, if you give me a minute to share my screen, what we were just talking about off camera with regards to XRP, because you had asked me two important questions on our last podcast that we've done our team some very copious research, as you are aware, as to XRP's validity with respect to a coin and with respect to BRICS. So we have, so just bear with me a minute. We have BRICS coming up, as you know, I think about 2 weeks from now, 160 countries in total. Iraq, Sri Lanka, and Cuba have just onboarded. You know, Putin spent a considerable amount of time. I just met with Alistair McLeod. He was talking about this. Considerable amount of time with Putin making concerted effort to get people over BRICS now, and he's having a lot more success than he was a year prior. So you had asked me, or you had opined about showing a tangible way that XRP is provable, right? That we could point to it. And I think we found something for you. Okay. So if you allow me to give me a second to share my screen, I will show you some things I think help point in that direction. So this is no surprise to you, but I got to go through it for posterity. So last week, Ripple and Mercado, there goes back to Bitcoin, partnered to launch cross-border payments in what? Brazil. There you go. BRICS, right? Lining up with them. But this is the article that really got my attention and got me pretty excited. And I'm, can you see it here about BRICS XRP for oil payment? Okay. So what's exciting is this happened back on August 12th, but they bury this stuff to try to suppress it. No surprise. Mm-hmm. But one of our team members, John G, found it. And what's exciting is, as you know, India did their first oil transaction with China on the petro yuan away from the dollar. But as you see, it was integrated with the XRP system on the ISO 20022 blockchain. Now, I went ahead to my bank, which is Wells Fargo. Don't love them, but that's not the point. At the Wealth Management Center in my area. And I asked them, are you guys on the QFS, Quantum Financial System? Yes. Are you Basel III? Yes. Okay. Are you familiar with XRP? Yes, we are. And I talked to a manager and a wealth manager there to get, you know, try to get the highest level that I could. You know, did you know about this transaction? Yeah, as a matter of fact, we just read about it. So then you acknowledge that the blockchain is moving. They said, oh yeah, it's been in our system for years, tested, and now it's moving. So it's pretty exciting for us because we believe that denotes, based on what the banks are telling us, that XRP is provable. It is working, as you can see, in concert with BRICS. What's exciting to us in our camp about BRICS is that it's going to help these countries de-dollarize and nationalize their currencies and tangible assets vis-a-vis gold. So you got gold, physical gold, you got Chinese and Russian bonds, which are iterations of gold, and probably some iteration of silver. And you had asked me last time, as I had asked you, did we think this was the year? And because of what I just shared with XRP, what I just shared with the BRICS with you, and because of the UN General Assembly 2 weeks ago, where you heard a lot of these countries like Iraq, like Zambia, and many other countries tacitly say sovereignty, nationalism, peace, prosperity, things I had not heard them say, certainly in years, maybe ever before in my lifetime, and even asking for debt forgiveness to as a means to get away from the dollar enslavement system. Because of those three mechanisms, Lynette, is our humble personal professional belief that this is the year that they are going to start to de-dollarize. Now, I know I saw your podcast where you said definitely for 2025, but we believe it starts now. My question to you would be, as we met with Peter Schiff a couple weeks ago, and I asked him the same question, so I'm really interested to get your take, which is to say, with all that said, setting the table, because of the UN General Assembly meeting with them saying what they said, is that enough of a constituent or a basis for them to not announce it in a couple weeks because they kind of already did? Would they just kind of do it and not mention it?
I think they would probably more do it than not mention it. Mm-hmm. But I would also like to point out that, and you might know this different than me, I have anything that was actually convertible. So provable is one thing, but a lot of countries in the BRICS don't really hold their general public in particularly high esteem. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I always have to go back to that convertibility because that's when the public lost its power. And that's what I want to see come back in. I know we're going in a digital direction. And they can also, you know, like the unit that they're talking about, is 40%. They want you to hear 40% gold, but pegged to gold. It is not convertible into it. And if it's pegged, then that means it's tied to a price. So, you know, do I think that they're de-dollarizing? Absolutely. And I think that that started really with the advent of the euro, quite honestly. That was created to do that. But it's still, even when you look at the BRICS currency, it's going to be a combination of their groups. So I'm going to pull you back to the SDR, because that's the one that I think is probably the most likely one to come over as the next the world reserve currency, where they have similarities. It's a basket of currencies, right? And that's what they're talking about at the BRICS, doing a basket of currencies for cross-border trading. That's great. That needs to happen to keep the global economy humming. But it doesn't really do anything to, that I can see, wrong, to ensure the purchasing power value to the public. And that's what I care, quite honestly, the most about. So you want to de-dollarize, you want to de-BRICS. The BRICS aren't going to save you and me or whoever is in the US or in advanced economies. You want to de-dollarize, convert your dollars into gold and silver, physical, in your possession. And for a BRICS currency, I don't want it pegged. Pegging means nothing. And no peg has ever lasted historically, period. So I don't think this time is different. But I do know that the way that they shift you from one currency system into the next currency system is to keep things appearing as normal as possible. I think we should all de-dollarize. In fact, I think we should all demonetize from any current, wherever you are in this world. Your government, your central banks are abusing your trust and belief.
And I mean,
de-dollarize trust.
And that's kind of what we're doing, is de-dollarizing by virtue of these conversations. I hear what you're saying, and I did ask your point of view, and I respect it. I appreciate it.
Different one, and I respect that as well.
Yeah, I mean, well, we've always had a nice dialogue. That's what we're trying to, we're just trying to find truth. How we do it and the road that we take to get there may be different, but as long as we end up at the same inroad, that's all that matters. And we're just trying to, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, you know, really to your point, John, it's all about building this community. We don't have to all think the same exact way.
Sure.
Important for everybody, including me, to hear all these different conversations and have them. And go inside and you go, okay, what feels right to me? And oh, by the way, a bit of diversification is not a horrendous thing.
Right. Right. Just 2 points, if I may, just to interject to what you said, is you said a key thing, you haven't seen it yet. I think I'll go back to what I said to you earlier. We're in a season where things that people said would never happen are going to happen. And we're going to see a lot of surprises. We believe humbly this is one. And as far as Zimbabwe is concerned, you have to remember, Lynette, that they're dealing with the same crap we're dealing with here in America, throughout the entire world, corruption. Edwin Mingawa is not the people's choice for them. They have a gentleman named Nelson Chamisa, which I encourage you to look into. Forget faith and politics. I'm just stating facts, like 2 + 2, whether you like it or not. Right. He is a Christian. He is a godly man. A lot of these countries copy each other. Like what's going on in here is going on in Iraq and vice versa. But he is all about monetary policy, bringing gold back. They have some of the most amount of gold reserves in the world. Otherwise, China wouldn't want to get at them. We know what they're trying to do with $300 million of mining. Why would they do that if Zimbabwe doesn't have the goods? So there should be no question about that. But my point to you is that why you're not seeing it yet is because the corruption, the film of corruption has not been removed yet. We believe through a number of factors, including our channels, are helping to facilitate that as we help people take the scales of brainwashing from the monetary system off their eyes, they can see clearly, engenders more community, engenders more truth, and engenders more of that, of people having a seat at the table, which we both want. So I would just encourage you to see that the reason Zimbabwe hasn't worked yet is because it's system as that changes. I'm sorry?
No, keep going, because you're right.
As that changes, which we believe from what we're able to see, it's going to be a very different outlook for Zimbabwe and many other countries. And I think BRICS is part of a bigger equation of allowing these countries to do just that. And that's all I was going to say.
Yeah, and I think that you're absolutely right, because they talk, but they don't walk their talk. And that takes me back to my father, who I always hate to say this because it makes him sound less than, and to me, he's the greatest man that ever lived.
Sure.
Always say to me, and I think it was part of the preparation for who I am and how I work, honestly, because he's always say to me, well, do what I say and not what I do. Though he was always talking about driving, because he never looked behind him.
When he hit somebody.
Okay, my niece was there. He kind of hurt her a little bit, but she was okay.
Thank God.
I know. So really, to your point, they can say anything they want. You've got to watch what they do.
Yeah.
Words do not align with their actions, you know it's a lie. And I would say that would be true for anybody that you're looking at. Say anything that they want, but what are they doing? So I read what they're writing, I listen to what they're saying, and then I watch what they're doing. And if their words support their actions, rock and roll hoochie coo, I know it's the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Even going back to Zimbabwe, and the truth is on the other side of this mess, and I think it's got to be a global reset, not just a little country here.
The entire world.
Yeah, that'd be the whole world, and that we have to deal with an awful lot of pain. It's not going to be easy, but when people say, "Well, they'll just back a currency with gold," well, when you do that, it fixes the debt where it is, and the debt is not payable. The only way to repay that debt is to print enough money to repay it with a currency that has no value.
Yeah.
So, you know, we've got to be the great unifier. We've got to come together.
Yeah.
And have, to your point, a seat at the table, and that seat at the table must make it convertible, not just provable. It must be convertible. And that's what I think we're going to see, is that Bretton Woods 3, we're going to see that at the end of the day. Because aren't we seeing more and more asset-backed currencies? So they're calling it backing, but is it convertible into the underlying asset? Because if it's not, go prove anything.
Mm-hmm.
How do you know if they're telling you the truth? You have to have the tools to hold their toes to the fire. If it's convertible, you don't really need to convert it unless you don't like their behavior.
Right. And we agree that actions speak louder than words. I think you know that. But what's interesting, I'll leave you with this thought, Lynette, to chew on for another time. It's sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy what the Fed is doing. They're sort of eating themselves from within, which is in turn forcing these other countries, whether they're on board or not, to de-dollarize and revalue their currencies in assets. And when I say assets, I'm not just talking about gold, Lynette, also silver, platinum. You got a country like, El Salvador or Zimbabwe, who's got rich crops. So their crops, they could trade in, as funny as it sounds, bananas and other things. I mean, what are you talking about? Bartering. I think we're looking at a global reset that's based on a barterability asset in many idioms, not just gold, which would further prove the point that Zimbabwe and many other countries are going to be able to revalue in something tangible. There's a little bit of something for you to think about. So, you know, and again, the point of this is to have a good, healthy discourse, right? An ethos that thinks outside a transcendental way, that challenges us all to grow. And at the same time, to your point, unify, which is what I know you're all about. So thank you for that.
I mean, I can tell you that here at Zang Enterprises, I like people with strong opinions. I have to have my opinion. I don't want to be surrounded by a whole bunch of me's, because then you don't see anything.
Right.
Me need to have people around you that have different opinions and different thought processes, and you have to embrace those. You don't have to necessarily agree with everything.
Right.
A good discourse where you have all of these people coming together, that's how you build a strong community.
Right.
If you're building, like I'm building for my bug out location, I'm planning on 40 people there. Well, if all I have up there are farmers, who's gonna build the chicken coop, right? Who's gonna fix the electrical? If I get sick, who's gonna fix me, right? So you need a community, you need diversity. You need diversification. We need it in discourse so we can determine what is the truth for me, right?
Yep.
And cooperation, and everybody brings all those different skill sets, the different thought processes, the different assets together. Boy, we are a fortress.
Absolutely. And to your point with us, you're hearing something that a little bit of a different vantage point than maybe you have with other people, which adds to the diversification of your cachet of your community. So Lynette, thank you for your time. As always, look forward to having you on again. Where can people find your work, and any last thoughts you have for the audience today?
Well, they can, first of all, the last thought is stop procrastinating if you've been procrastinating, and get prepared. And what you need to be prepared with is food, water, energy security, barterability, wealth preservation, community and shelter. And at Zang Enterprises, we focus on all of those pieces. The only difference between gold and silver and blueberries or other commodities or other things is that this is universally accepted. And if I have blueberries and I want your strawberries, but you don't like blueberries, I have to go find somebody else, right? So it just makes bartering, silver does, that's my key barterable tool.
Agreed.
It just makes it easier, but anything physical, any talent that you have is barterable. So keep that in mind. And I would also say there are all sorts of ways to accumulate physical gold and silver, you know, between jewelry, flatware, all of that kind of stuff. And frankly, all of that is monetary at its base, and it doesn't matter what the condition is. So having said all that, you can find my work on YouTube and Twitter at the Lynette Zang, and on Instagram and Facebook at Lynette Zang. And you can go to LynetteZang.com, where you will find Zang Enterprises. And I have to tell you that every single person that is at Zang Enterprises is here to be of value and service and benefit the community. So we do deal in physical gold and silver, but what we like to do is have this conversation and make sure that you have your goals established. What are you trying to accomplish? Then in all of those areas, we put together a strategy for you, a sound money strategy to help you accomplish your goals. That's who we are. That's what we're about.
And 60 plus years in the industry certainly denotes that as well. So awesome. Thank you, Lynette, for being here. We'll look forward to having you again soon in this critical season we're in on this next podcast. And thank you for your valuable insight and input. We look forward to seeing you again shortly.
I hope so. And thank you so much for having me, John. It's always fun. And
it's
I
an honor.
Something, and that's what I like. I am definitely a lifelong learner, and I appreciate it very much.
Likewise. Thank you so much. God bless and take care.